Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Hectorial. We're going to get started here in a few minutes after people have finished filing in. But take this time to go and download After Effects and Photoshop. You can use a trial if you need to. And otherwise, enjoy some Sheryl Crow for the moment. Enjoy. Well, it started, so. Kunal, can you monitor the live stream? Just tell me if anything is on. So, thank you. Great. All right, folks. How are we doing today, everybody?
Yeah.
All right. We're still going to give it a couple more minutes, but for those who just filed in, does everyone have After Effects and Photoshop installed? Raise your hand if you don't. It's okay. We'll come help. Cool. Ishan, can you help? If we get to the start and it's still not ready to go, that's fine. Just share with the person next to you, and you'll still pick up all the fun skills. Hello, live stream peoples. Can you hear me okay? Oh, right. Where were we? Let's see. Let's get through one more crappy tune. Okay, everybody, we just hit 7:10, so we'll get started now. Thanks again for coming. You're hanging out with Terrapin Hackers here at the UI Animation and Motion Design Hacktorial. Who here has been to a Hacktorial before? Solid. Who's a first-time Hacktorial goer? Cool. Who here is a developer or engineer? And who here is a designer or wants to be one? Cool. Well, hopefully today we can teach everyone, either if you're an aspiring designer, how to pick up some of those skills that can really get you far in industry, or if you're on the engineering side or any other field, you'll be able to at least understand how this stuff works and do some cool stuff with it on the side. or hey, join me in the design world. So my name is Jeff Hillenbrand. I am a super senior here. 5 years is more fun. And let's see, I have done a couple hectorials before with Kunal and the lovely Terrapin Hackers team. This is the first one on any sort of animation or motion, so it'll be pretty different. I think it'll be pretty challenging for everyone, myself included, to be able to teach this and pick it all up. But it's a really great skill to have, and so let's get started. So I'm Jeff. If you have questions or want to follow up with me, Twitter is where I spew stuff and also share really cool links and have fun. You can reach me there. So right now I am running a design agency with my partner Dan and our new PM Amritha. We're called Mini Mill, and we do branding and websites and mobile apps on the design and development side. This is an example of something that you might be able to create today at the end, maybe. We'll see. Cool. So why is motion useful at all? Does anyone want to throw out maybe some ideas of why they think motion is relevant to technology at all? Zach, I saw you raise your hand there.
It gives things depth.
Gives things depth, okay. Okay.
It allows the UI to parallel the physical world.
Interesting. He said it allows the UI to parallel the physical world that a user is used to. One more, Steph, maybe? What do you got?
Technology is always in motion. It's evolving.
Cool. So I'll break down three like practical or pragmatic uses of motion in the context of tech. One is interaction, right? So this is if you're using a product, whether it's a mobile app or a website or a physical product with some sort of electronic interface, the way that the information and the content is presented to you is dynamic. It's never static. And so animations and motion allow you to provide context to those interactions and enhance that experience. So here are a few examples. These are all pulled from some of my previous work. There's a ton of really great stuff out there if you browse the internet or the Dribble Sphere or something like that. But here's an example of something we're going to make today. This is a fun little side project I did with the kid, Jax Geller, over here. We print shirts out of our living room, and this was a site to display those. So when Jackson and I were prototyping this website, I made this animation to show him exactly how the interaction should go, how we should transition from a grid view to a single shirt view to present these shirts in the gallery. Here's an example of something I'm working on now. It's an interaction that allows you to start an audio player and learn more information about a certain landmark. So that was motion for interaction. Motion for presentation is something that's gotten really big recently. This is the idea that while it's not necessarily the exact way something operates in a product, it's presenting information in an engaging and dynamic way. So it might get a fair amount of flack, but Dribbble is a great place for this sort of stuff to present your portfolio or works in progress. It's a community for designers, and you'll see this stuff all over the place. Little animations to show off logos or other sorts of content. So these are a few that I've made. You can see, again, it's really just taking that end logo and making it a little more engaging and presenting it with that motion. Here's another one. This is actually for the same client. Again, just finding a way to give each individual element its screen time and making it engaging to switch between them. And one more, this is using animation to show off an icon, a logo, and a website all in one GIF, which is easily distributable throughout the whole internet. Cool. And then we have motion for fun. This is going to be our catch-all. When you just want to make something that's cool for fun, that's totally valid. This is a little keyboard animation we made one night. And I think I'm spelling out my name, if I remember correctly. Cool. So with those three topics of how you can use motion in tech, let's go into how you can do that well. So the format of this talk, by the way, is going to be a brief intro here, and then we're going to get into After Effects and get our hands dirty making that interaction that I showed you earlier. Folks in the back, you guys hear me okay? Solid? Awesome. Great. So I don't want you guys to just learn After Effects and go crazy with it. Hopefully you're also learning some of the principles that make for really good motion design. So good motion design is defined by, here are 3 points that I think will really help if you're deciding if something is worth doing, or you know, if you're making a decision, try coming back to these 3 points as goals. So number one, yeah, goal oriented. Whatever you're making should have an objective. It shouldn't necessarily be just a random animation for animation's sake. It should have a goal, and bad would be pointless. So even though some of the animations I did before that I showed you are not necessarily like required, or they didn't enhance a user experience, the point of those, as I explained, was maybe to show more content through one image, or to present it in a more dynamic way. Everything you do with animation and motion should be goal-oriented. Number two is technical. This is my personal style. When I design stuff, I'm always thinking about the numbers. What is the duration of this? What is half of that? What is, are they lined up correctly? And I think that's really important to keep yourself organized and to keep your final products orderly and coordinated, as opposed to like a haphazard animation which might have the same content but without the same timing or the same sizing or something like that. So as we go through this, I want everyone to really pay attention to the numbers that we're throwing out and observe, oh, that's half of that, or that lines up perfectly with that. It'll really help you understand how these things are coordinated. And three is subtle. I think that especially in products, people can go kind of crazy and have stuff flying all over the place. If you've ever explored Dribbble, which I've brought up a few times, you'll know what I mean. And I think that all of good motion design is defined by as little motion as possible to communicate what you need to do. So aim for subtle instead of gratuitous and annoyingly flashy. So this is probably where a lot of you are with motion design. This is a screen from PowerPoint. Which is your favorite? Anyone have a favorite? Someone has a favorite. I like Dissolve. It's the most annoying. But yeah, these are a lot of the transitions that people are used to from presentations, and I don't really like them. They're certainly not subtle. You can do stuff like this, which is really cool. But we're not going to make that. We're going to make hopefully something a little more exciting than a motion path. This is an example of quite the opposite. What I was saying before about gratuitous animation for no reason at all. This is from an article that kind of criticizes the stuff about, they say that your UI isn't a Disney movie. I think, when you're just getting started with this, a lot of people will think, oh, it needs to be more exciting, it needs to be more fun, let me add more bounces and movement. But really, like, the minimalism or the minimalist approach to this sort of work is really the move. And think about how subtle you can be while still communicating what you need to do. Otherwise, you'll end up like this. I like this GIF. And Ishan challenged me to put it in the presentation, so there you go. Great. So, has anyone heard form versus function? Has anyone heard that expression or term? Some of you have. You're nodding. Great. So this comes up a lot in design, often in architecture or physical product design, but it's really relevant to 2D as well. I think that when you're balancing form, which means the aesthetic or the visual of a product or an interface in our case, versus the function. This is what it does, the programming, the point of something. We want to find how animation and motion can enhance both of these. So when you're thinking about form, this is the visual, the experience of something. When you use animation, you have the opportunity to delight someone. So this is going beyond just a standard benchmark form, and it's delighting someone. This is, you know, that experience when you're maybe using a mobile app and you go, oh, wow, like that animation there, or that little interaction was just super cool. That's called delight. And on the other side, once something functions and it programs, it works, you have the opportunity to increase efficiency. So this is maybe providing extra context or explaining how something got there with animation. These are the things that you can do, you know, to help the user, to delight the user, to make them faster. And this is why we do it at all, instead of going just from screen to screen. Cool. So who's heard of material design? Cool. If anyone's programmed for Android, it's probably come up. This is the new like visual style of Google products. And what they've done is really brought this idea of like meaningful animation into the limelight. So we're going to watch a quick video to just get some ideas rolling around. So this is a bit of an abstraction from what's actually going on in the apps, but you can see how they're really considering how animation is providing context and delighting the user. Pretty cool. Designers worship this stuff. All right. So again, when you go and are making apps in the future, really consider how you know motion applies there. So now we're going to get into a bit of the technical stuff. This is what you're going to need to know to eventually make these animations in a few minutes. So number one is parameters. These are, I'm going to go through some of the core things that make up motion. So we're going to start with transforms. This is going to be the bulk of what we're using to change things. A transform is considering an object and its position, its opacity, its scale, etc. So I'm going to go over these because it's going to be the main pieces of information that we're going to be changing. So an anchor point is an origin around which transforms are centered. If I have an anchor point in the middle of this object and I scale it, it'll scale in all directions, 1, 2, 3, 4. But if I have an anchor point here and I scale something, it'll only go outwards this way because the anchor point is down here. That'll make more sense later when we're actually using it. Position is pretty obvious. These are your Cartesian coordinates, x and y. If you're getting fancy, you can do things in the z scale. For today, we're just going to use x and y. Scale is the size of an object, making it bigger and smaller. Rotation is the spin or the rotation. We all know that one. And opacity is the transparency of an object. So opacity 1 means it's fully opaque, no light passes through. And opacity 0 means it's fully transparent. All right, we'll get into those in more depth. There will be other things, but it'll all make sense once we get started. And the last thing that I want to go over from a technical sense is easing. Easing is kind of what makes UI animation magical. If you've ever tried this before and maybe it's looked a little off or something like that, chances are it's in the easing. This is considering you know, the start and stop of a certain parameter. So if you're moving something from here to here, what this animation is demonstrating is you know, if you have a linear easing curve, that means that it's going linearly. The acceleration and the velocity, they're not changing. It's going all the way there, linearly. But using easing curves will make it have a bit of a more physical interaction to go from A to B. So we'll go over those more later as well. That's what the Ease and Wiz plugin is for, if anyone was able to get that installed. Here are a few more easing curves. If you're a very technical nut, this is going to be a lot of fun to figure out which easing curve is right for you. But for purposes today, we're all going to use one together. And just for more context, this stuff is baked into the software you're writing. So this is just a screen from Android. These are, you know, really easy curves that you can use that are already baked into the platform. Cool. So to go over getting started, first I wanted to show you the very first motion design project I ever did. It was for one of the dance groups here at Maryland, and I had no idea what I was doing and made this in After Effects. And I think it's cool because, you know, it's cool to see like progress from where you started. And so when you guys are doing this after today, I think it'll be really interesting to see like where you guys are versus where you'll be with a little bit more work. So this was 4.5 years ago, and now we're doing stuff in UI design. But we're not going to watch the entire video. You can find that on YouTube if you really want to. The workflow we're going to do today to get started is Illustrator to After Effects to Photoshop. Now, I didn't ask everyone to download Illustrator because I'm providing source files for everyone. And so while we're at it, why doesn't everyone go to that Facebook event and click the source files link? It'll open a Dropbox folder and download everything within that to your desktop or somewhere. You can do that while I keep talking. Illustrator is where all of these files were made. It's a piece of software used for vector artwork editing. And so it's used to make every single individual element or object that we're going to be animating in After Effects. Is anyone having trouble finding that that link? Cool. For anyone on the live stream, it should be in the description. It should say source files, and it opens up a Dropbox link. All right, and then within After Effects, what we're going to be doing is editing those parameters I talked about over keyframes. So this is changing some of those parameters over time and seeing how an object moves. And finally, Photoshop is used for those little bits of exports at the end. And it makes it so that we can distribute this in a GIF form, which we might not have time for, but I'll try to get to, depending on how fast we go. All right. So was everyone able to download those source files? Raise your hand if you're having trouble finding them. OK, can you help them back there? The link is going to be in the event group, or in the event comments. Cool, cool, cool. All right, everyone, open After Effects. Here we go. So as I said, I've provided a bit of source files. The way that works is that you're going to start from the document entitled, I believe it's Hactorial-PantsChanger-1-Layers. Does everyone see that? Let me see if I can find it myself. So by the way, the reason this is called Pants Changer is because that was the name of our little shirt project. That's the name of the interface we're playing with. Cool. So I provided 4 different versions of this After Effects file. So if you ever get lost, you can pick up wherever we are by downloading the appropriate one. So those are 4 different steps along the way. And if you get lost, definitely raise your hand and ask a question. Ishan will be able to help you or some of the other Terrapin Hackers organizers. But if you're totally bonkers lost, just cut your losses and download where we are now. So we're going to start by opening up this file called Hactorial Pants Changer 1 Layers. Alrighty. Is everyone able to get that open? Cool. I'll keep rolling. If I'm going too fast or if you get stuck, just raise your hand and interrupt me. All right. So first, a tour of After Effects. Again, this is a piece of Adobe software that's used for motion. All of these assets were generated in Illustrator or in Photoshop or elsewhere, and we've imported them here. If anyone's having like linking issues, let me know, but you shouldn't be because they're all in that folder. So yeah, the tour of After Effects. On our left here, we have our project pane. This is where source files are coming from. So if you're starting a project from scratch, you'll drop them in there to start. Up here is our preview window. As we go through the animation, it'll show us you know, what we've created. And then at the bottom, we have the sequencer. This is basically the main place that you're doing your work. It's where you're adjusting everything and creating keyframes. And so we'll break that down a little more since it's a little more complex. On the left, we have a list of all of our layers. They're given titles that should correlate to the sort of object they are. We have some sort of parameters that we probably won't get to today. And then on the right, we have that sequencer where you have bars that represent each layer. And within those bars, are going to be parameter keyframes. The last thing you need to know is up here on the right, we have a preview pane, and that's where you have like your player. You can play and stop the animation. Just for full context, I'm going to open up the completed one and show you where we're going to go. So in this animation, what's happening is, again, it's demonstrating how a user enters a single gallery view by dragging their cursor over something, clicking it, and having it expand into the frame. And just for fun, here's what we did make. Jackson did a great job developing this. Let's see if it works. So in the end, this is what we got, right? So I've handed him a GIF or a movie file that he can take and make this out of. So it is pretty useful. I think it was helpful for Jackson to see all of that come together. All right. So all done with the context. Here's what we'll be creating. You see this down here? These are all keyframes. So I'm going to show you this end version, but don't worry. You're not supposed to be here yet. You can keep yours as is. Each of these dots on the timeline represents a different point in time. So you see how the player works. It goes through, and it's basically looking at where each keyframe is in time and what values are associated with that keyframe. So remember we talked about parameters. We have things like position, opacity, scale. What a keyframe does is it says, at this point in time, the scale is going to be 100%. So it's as it was originally. But at this point in time, it's going to be 90%. So what the timeline does is it looks over those keyframes, and it says, starting at 100, OK. And then it's going to end here. And we're going to interpolate what happens in between. So you go from 100 to 99, 95, 92, 0, right? Over that duration of time. So I can even play with the keyframes to change that. And that's what we will do. That's how this is all created. Cool. So the first thing we're going to do is work on that animation of the shirt expanding. So that's actually going to be using a number of the parameters that we'll be discussing today. All right, let me pause this and open up the layers file. Okay, so if everyone looks in their layers, I'm going to increase the resolution here because it's probably hard to see on the live stream. That's 1080p. Okay, well, that's about as good as we can do. Great, so everyone navigate in your sequence layers list to the object called shirt photo. Does everyone see that? Cool. So you're going to click the little arrow on the left. And what that does is it expands it and exposes all of the parameters. You have to go one level deep to open the transform parameters. And within this, you'll see the ones that I mentioned before. Anchor point, position, scale, rotation, and opacity. What we're going to do to start is just scale it from its corner. So does anyone have any ideas how we would do that? Yeah. Good start. Okay, and then what? Perfect. So Josh got it exactly right. What we're going to do is move the anchor point to this top left corner, and then we're going to scale it to the appropriate size. And what that'll do is instead of, again, scaling around its center, it's going to scale from the top left. So in order to do that, oh, and I already cheated, and I forgot to remove the anchor point that I preset. So you already, good job, everyone. You're one step in. Okay, usually the anchor point by default is going to be in the center of an object, and what you would have had to do previously, just so you can see, if this is in, you know, somewhere close to the center of an object, you'd have to edit it down to 0, 0 to make it in the top left. And again, that allows us to scale from the corner. Cool. So we actually don't need to make a keyframe from the origin for the anchor point because that doesn't change throughout the duration of this animation. What we do need to make a keyframe for is the scaling, because that's what's changing. It's getting bigger. So what we're going to do is, thinking back to the technical aspect of this, we're going to pick a keyframe that is nice with the numbers. So in this case, I think I have it at 24 frames per second. So this is the number of frames of the animation that will eventually output. And so when you think of 24 frames per second, half of that is 12, half of that is 6. So we're going to use those numbers for the durations of our animations. And we can tweak it later to make it like optically better for us. But we'll start with that. So let's give it some breathing room in the beginning and put our mouse over at 12F. That means 12 frames. So this is half a second in. We're giving a little bit of buffer for it to start, and then we're going to start our animation. By the way, I'm navigating around with the plus and minus key. This zooms in and out on our timeline. So you can press plus a few times after clicking within the sequencer and get in there. Cool. So from here, we're going to go over to scale and press the little time stopwatch icon. If you zoom in far enough, it should say frames. Does it not? There we go. Cool. Yeah, so when you're in like a macro view, it'll say seconds because that's the appropriate unit. But once you're zoomed in farther, it'll have F, which means frame, for more precise adjustments. So throughout After Effects, this stopwatch icon means create keyframe or toggle the ability to keyframe. So we're going to put our cursor over at 12 frames and click the stopwatch at scale. And you'll see a little diamond appear right where that line is. Was everyone able to do that so far? Cool. We have a diamond. So what that means is it's the start of our animation. It's the first keyframe. Now we're going to move our cursor over to 1 second, or the 1:00. And we're going to actually press the button all the way on the left, which is add keyframe. So once we've started an animation, it's created, you know, it's toggled keyframes on and said you have the ability to create these. And from then on, you need to use the one all the way on the left to create new keyframes. If you click the stopwatch again, that'll turn the ability to use keyframes off, and it'll keep that object static. So now that we've created a new keyframe at 1 second, which is, you know, a half second after we've started, we're going to increase that value. So let's make that, I believe it's 100%. Nope, it's not 100%. Let's see. We're just going to do this optically since I don't have all the measurements down. Let's set that to 58%. Everyone see how to do that? What you're going to do is create a keyframe at 1 second and then go into the value and change it to 5.8 by just clicking on it and typing 5.8. Cool. So now if you scrub the cursor back, you'll see that it's animating over time. And congratulations, you've just made your first animation. Woo! Good job, everybody. Now, in order to play that back, right. So by default, everything is going to be linear. Remember we talked about that? Going from A to B at a constant velocity. Later on, we'll talk about easing, but that'll be last. Cool. So we've created a little animation here. You can press the space bar to preview it. It'll run it for you, and you don't need to scrub the cursor at all. You can play with that a little bit. And I think I set the work area to 4 seconds. Which is going to be the duration of the animation. If this was a stock a stock After Effects file, you would have to move this piece back to make it loop like that. But don't worry about that for now. Cool. So now that we've scaled this up, the next thing we're going to do is insert that green background. So if you go down to where it says green background, you can expand using the triangles on the left all the way into the transform parameters. Give you a second to do that. And you'll notice that opacity, unlike all the other objects right now, is set to 0. So this means it's transparent by default. Again, this is just how I've optimized the source file for you guys. But if you brought in raw files, you would have to do that yourself. So what we're going to do is actually line up our timeline cursor with the first keyframe. So just drag that that blue piece there to where the first keyframe is, and then we're going to go down to green background and toggle keyframes for opacity. By the way, if you need more viewing room, you can grab this pane and just pull it up. It'll make your preview smaller, but you'll be able to see the timeline better. Yeah. Plus and minus. We'll zoom in and out. But you have to click within the sequencer first. You mean like this?
Yeah.
Cool, great. So now that everyone's created your first keyframe for the green background, we're going to move our cursor back over to the 1 second mark, where the end of the scaling animation ends. And we're going to create another keyframe there. And this time, instead of making it 58%, which was for the scale, we're going to make it 100%. Cool. And going back to what I was saying about technical, technical implementation on all this, you want to be thinking again about which pieces are going together, which pieces are staggered. In this case, we've made something that has the exact same keyframing, so it's going to look like one congruent animation instead of like a cascade effect, which is used a lot, which will bring things in at different times and emphasize each element differently. So if we scrub through this again, we'll see that we're scaling this up and changing the background all at once. Cool. Is everyone at that stage? Everyone solid? Great. So now just for fun, let's throw in some easing. Or actually, no, we're going to save that for the end. That's when the big reveal happens, and it all looks sexy and buttery. Great. So at this point, we're going to work on the title. By the way, all of the images that we're not using, we don't have to touch. Unlike, say, if you were coding this, we don't actually have to deal with the stuff that we don't need to demonstrate. So in this case, everything from that original logo to the other shirt panels on this interface, we don't have to deal with it all because, again, we're just doing this to demonstrate how the interaction works. So you can see them at the bottom. They're there. I can toggle them on and off just to show you, but we don't need to touch those at all. Okay, so from here, what we're going to work on is I'm just going to pull this up for reference just so we can see it during. Okay, so what's going to happen in this animation next is that you can see here that the title slides in, right? So unlike a PowerPoint wipe, it's very subtle. It comes in with an opacacity and a translation parameter keyframe adjustment stuff. So the way this breaks down is we have the object translate up a few pixels and also fade in. And that's how it looks like it's kind of emerging out of nowhere. It's very subtle. It's nice. Great. So that's what we're going to do next. So everyone find the, what did we call it? Shirt title card. And you can only view it in your sidebar, the layer list, because it doesn't actually exist yet. It's fully transparent because the opacity is dialed down to zero again. Similarly to how the green background was. Okay, we're going to open our transform up by clicking those little triangles on the side and get down to opacity. So we're going to do this part first, just so we can see it. Now in this case, we only want to fade it in after the green has made its way in. So just for simplicity, let's start our new fade in at the very end of the previous animation. So this is at 1 second. So click the toggle keyframe icon for the opacity. Let's bring it over to 12 frames again and bump that up to 100. Does everyone understand that interaction of like editing keyframes and values? Is that pretty straightforward so far? Cool. So from here on, I'll just say it as if you know it, and stop me if you need more briefing. But here we can see we have now a scale, a fade, and then another fade for the title. And the fade for the title is coming after the full animation finishes for part one. So from there, remember, this is a two-parameter animation. So what's really cool about objects in Illustrator is you can do whatever you want to them, and each parameter acts independently. So you complex animations are complex, intros or whatever, are created by adjusting multiple parameters. So in this case, we're adjusting opacity and position. So go back to that 1 second mark, and we're going to make a keyframe for position, and then we're going to go to the 1 second, 12 frames mark, and we're going to adjust the position. So in this case, let's set this to something like 140. Oh, nope, my bad. Let's say 100. And so what this is doing, in the position, you have two parameters, or let's say two sub-parameters under the position parameter. You have the X, which comes first, and the Y, which comes second. So what I've done is I've created a keyframe at the beginning for the original position, and then I've gone to the end and created a second keyframe, edited the Y value so it goes up, and pressed enter. So now we have that nice fade in. You see that? Does everyone have that so far? Cool. So like I said in the beginning, this looks pretty stock right now. We'll get to easing. That's when it looks all buttery and smooth. But bear with the linear easing for simplicity's sake for now. All right. Cool. For the purpose of this demonstration, I'm going to leave out some of the more advanced interactions that happen in this animation, like the numbers increasing. And if we have time at the end, we can go over that as well. Okay. So next, let's work on the divider line. So what's cool about this is if you see in the beginning, here, I'll make this a little bigger. You see this divider line here? That goes at the very bottom of the header, and it separates the header from the content. We want to maintain that in the new page, but unfortunately, the dark color of the divider line, which made sense on a light gray in the beginning, doesn't work anymore on the green. It doesn't have enough contrast. So what we're going to do is over the duration of the green fading in, we're also going to change the color of the stroke of the divider line. So to break that down, the color, we're going to bring it from black to white to make the contrast go from dark on light to light on dark. Cool? So we can see it better. The stroke means the outline or the line itself. And yeah, so we're going to do that over the duration of the green fading in. So if we open up the divider dark line over here, in this case, you'll see something called content. So this is actually a shape that was made directly inside of After Effects. Some of the other shapes are made in Illustrator and imported, or in Photoshop, or are, you know, PNGs or something like that. They're raw images. But in this case, I've created a shape directly inside of After Effects, and we're going to manipulate that. The point of doing this is that you have more control over the exact points and the colors and the content parameters of that object. Actually, let's do this the hard way. Yeah? Do you want to learn how to make shapes from scratch? It'll just take a second. Cool. So everyone, take the leap and just click on divider dark and delete it. Woohoo! Badass. Okay. So from here, we're going to actually create a wholly new object in that place, and we're going to basically simulate what was just there. We're going to waste a little bit of time. That's okay. So go to the top and press layer, new, and shape layer. Everyone got it? So within shape layer, it's actually a totally blank layer right now. There's nothing inside of it because you don't see anything. There's nothing there. We need to add all of the objects inside of it. So inside shape layer, if you click the triangle to view its contents, you can go to where the contents row is and click the add icon. So from there, we're going to add a rectangle. And I know the line at the end doesn't seem like a rectangle. It looks like a line, a 2D line. But that has thickness too, so that's why we're using a rectangle. And we'll be able to adjust the thickness in a sec. Great. So within the rectangle path, this goes deeper and deeper and deeper. Sometimes you might have an After Effects document that is like 10 layers deep of the parameters you're adjusting. So go inside Contents, Rectangle Path 1, and we're going to play with the size. So this is actually the raw dimensions of the object. For simplicity's sake, we'll leave it at 100 for width, but we're going to change the Y height, you know, the height of the object, and make it look more like a line. So if you notice just now, I clicked this lock icon. Does everyone see that lock icon? If you uncheck that, it'll allow you to adjust the X and Y, or the width and height, without it constraining the proportion. So if we didn't check that off, it would only scale up and down, maintaining the one-to-one proportion, the square. And so we're actually allowing ourselves to change those proportions. And we're going to make the second size subparameter 4. Cool? So now we have an object that's 100 pixels long and 4 pixels tall. It looks something like a 4-pixel stroke. So from there, we're going to adjust the position to put it back where it originally was. So if we need to get it up to the top, which position subparameter are we going to change? The second one, right. So you can adjust this, just pull it on up. And you'll see it in your preview pane marked with an outline. I brought mine up to, let's say, minus 120. Again, if you were coming from an actual design, you would want to get all these numbers really precise, but we'll just keep it simple for today. Cool. Does everyone see how to bring that up? Awesome. So in this case, you'll notice that we're adjusting the parameters without actually creating any keyframes. So what this is doing differently is instead of animating over time, we're adjusting the actual, like the static value of where this is. Does that make sense? Cool. So what's cool about Illustrator, and I mean, I guess this has been refined over the years, it's a pretty standard pattern now, but it all kind of goes together and we're using the same tools to do different things, which is pretty cool. Okay, so now that we have that in place, we have a raw rectangle, but it actually has no fill. There's nothing inside it. It's an empty shape. So we're going to go back up to content and add to add a fill. Cool. Now that we've done that, we can go inside of it and change the color. Let's just make it black. All right. Or you can make it any color you want. Have fun with it. So now, if you look at it, it's pretty similar to how it was before. It's a little bit heavier, but we'll go with it for now. Is everyone at this stage? Raise your hand if you're stuck somewhere. Good job, folks. Good job. How are we doing on the live stream? Is that even still going? Oh, cool. Good work, everybody. All right, so back into After Effects. So the reason we did all this, the reason we bothered creating a shape at all, is that the same way we can animate the transform parameters, the position, the opacity, etc., we can edit that color parameter, which is really cool. So the same way we edited the static value just now, we're going to make keyframes for that color and change it from black to white. So let's open everything up again. If we recall, we have some keyframes at 1 second, so that's where the green background finishes fading in, and so that's where the end of our line is going to be, our line animation. A quick trick, if you click inside the sequencer and you press Command A or Control A on Windows, and you'll select everything, and from here you can press U a few times to just pull up the edited keyframes. So this is really useful if you have a ton of different objects and you just want to see the things that are changing. Did everyone catch that shortcut? Go in the sequencer, press Command A, and press U a few times to toggle through viewing things with keyframes on. All right. So now we're going to go back into our shape layer, our contents, and we've lined our cursor up with the end of the scale up and green background change. And so that's actually going to be the end of our line color change. So first let's make our keyframe at the beginning of that. And we're going to go inside fill and start the keyframes for colors the same way we did other parameters. Then we're going to go to 1 second and change this to white. So click the color and change it all the way to white. Well, that sure is strange. Is it showing up for anyone else? Oh, I deleted mine. My bad. I hit it by accident. Okay. Hopefully you guys didn't encounter that. So again, color at 12 frames and then color again at 1 second. We're going to go from black to white. Was everyone able to do that? Great. So now we see all of that happening. It's pretty cool. In one step, we're changing the background, the size of the image, and the line color. And in the second step, we're fading in the title. So now we're going to go over some efficiency steps. We're going to copy and paste the animation we used to animate the title in, and we're going to use that on the sizes. So this is the text that goes right underneath that content there. So if you just go in the sequencer, drag on top of shirt title and select all of those keyframes, you can press copy. Actually, let's just do it for opacity first. So you can copy the opacity keyframes, and wherever you paste them, it will plug them in at the start of the cursor. So wherever you are in your timeline, that's where it'll paste those keyframes. So we're actually going to open, let's see. We're going to open where these numbers are. Do you see all these numbers? 3, 8, 4, 3S, 6M, 3L. Those are actually some metadata for the site. It represents the number of sizes of shirts that we have in stock, let's say. So instead of making keyframes for each of those, we're going to select all of them. So just go in the left-hand bar here and click on one of them and shift-click on another, and you'll select all of them. And then we can, having previously copied the opacity keyframes, just paste those right in. And now if we click U, we'll see that they've pasted in nicely, and now we're getting everything fading in all at once. Does everyone have that? Cool. Good work. All right, so the last thing we need to do is translate those up the same way that the title translates up. So we're going to, since this has a different starting location, we're going to do it a little differently than the title. So click the arrow, toggle it a couple times until you see the transform parameters pop up. And we're going to change the position with the same duration, and we'll just increase it a little bit. But do remember whatever number it's at. So if I'm going to make it 180, let's say, oops, I meant 140, then let's remember 140 and just repeat that process for each of those numbers. So go in to position, go to the start, toggle keyframes, go to the end, and type in 140, and do that for all of them. I'll give you guys a moment on that. Oh my, I'm the wrong number there. When you're done, you should have something that looks like this. We have the background fading out, or rather the background fading in, the image scaling, the name and size breakdown sliding up and fading in, and our white bar fading in as well. Now you'll see that there's like a second white bar there. That's because I was using it differently before. I would just ignore that for now. And you can adjust any of the parameters we've done so far. If you want this to go over a really long duration of time, for example, here's what that would look like. Let's say we want to fade it in over like 2 seconds to be dramatic or something. We could do that, and it would look like this. But we're not going to do that. Alrighty, so at this point, we're going to go over easing. We'll finally get to making it look really cool. So again, to review what easing does, right now everything is on a linear interpolation. That means from start to stop, it is going at a constant velocity, and it goes as fast as it needs to go to get from A to B. With easing, you're changing that velocity. You're making it accelerate in and then accelerate down, or maybe start at a really high velocity and decelerate. And the point of this is to make it look a little more human, a little more, you know, physically based. Things don't just start and stop in the real world, they ease into it. And you can use this for stylizing any sort of animation in the future. So who here does not have Ease and Wiz installed? Okay, seems like just a few of you. So just I would just look over someone else's shoulder to see this. It does take a couple minutes to install. What the point of this is Ease and Wiz is a custom plugin that does easing curves. So it allows you to apply these custom easing curves to the keyframes, and it does all that work for you. It's actually inputting, I believe, regular expressions into this. So it's putting a little bit of code into like how these are animating over time. But we just get to use the plugin because it is super convenient. All right, so in this case, we're going to start by just selecting everything. So you can click just Command A within the sequencer. And if this is your first time using Ease and Wiz, you'll need to go to Window, and you should see Ease and Wiz at the bottom if you've installed it correctly. Does everyone see Ease and Wiz in the window pane? If you don't, that's OK. Let's say so. Cool. All right, so click Ease and Wiz. It'll open a window. I store mine down here in the bottom. You can put it wherever you want. And the way to use Ease and Wiz is Command A. So we're just going to select every single keyframe. So everything we've animated, we're going to apply an easing curve to, just because fuck it. And so then we're going to say Expo, or actually we're going to change the easing curve to circular. That's just a different, you know, a slightly different easing algorithm. And then we're going to do type in out. So what this means is it's going to ease in and it's going to ease out. So it has that acceleration or the velocity change at the beginning and end of this animation. Alternatively, you could have something come in really fast from the start and then slow down, or start really slow and speed up and go out. But we're going to do in out. So from here, again, just select all the keyframes and apply the easing curve. So once you do that, next time you play it, it'll have to scrub through the first time and figure it out. But you'll see everything is a little bit snappier. It looks a little bit more like a product you would use instead of a slow, boring, linearly easing piece of shit. did everyone get that far? Awesome. Yeah?
I'm trying to install it easily. It says that the app type is
supported. Okay, we'll have to figure that out later. For you, I would just stick to linear and know that this glory awaits you once you're able to get it installed.
Okay.
But yeah, like easing is a lot of fun. Again, it adds that little bit of magic to everything. Cool. So actually at this point, you've learned the bulk of what you'll ever need to know in After Effects. Pretty cool. And for sake of time, we're going to go through some future steps. We could finish animating this entire interface interaction, but we're going to go through some of the final steps so you know what to do with it when you're done. Is everyone at about this stage? You have something that moves? Yeah? Cool. Pat yourself on the back. We're going to export that. So go in After Effects to File, and then Export. And within Export, you have a few different options. Today we're going to use the Render Cube because it's really simple. But there are other options for different ways to export it in the future. So we're going to click File, Export, Add to Render Cube. So in here, you won't have all these previous projects. Or maybe you will. I don't know. You have them? OK. Well, that's my source file for you. This is raw. OK, so the only thing you need to change here is click Output 2, and just make that wherever you want. You can change the file name, all right, Hacktorial, and save it. OK, so once we've defined an output location, we need to go up to the top right and click Render. And listen to this. That is the most satisfying sound ever. That means you've completed an entire animation. So everyone turn your volume on, add to render queue, and let's hear it. Ooh, we've got one so far. This is great. Oh boy. All right, well, as the symphony continues, for those who have it exported, find wherever you downloaded it, or wherever you exported it. And what we're left with is an MOV file. Or if you have like Windows, it might have defaulted to something else, maybe an MP4. I'm not sure. But what this does is it is a movie file of what we've made. So we can view this. And you see it goes from start to finish, and it stops. So that's what movie files do. They're kind of heavy, they're big, and they don't distribute well. So we're going to convert this into a GIF for optimal sharing on the internet. Because at the end of the day, that's what we want people to do. We want to be able to have it autoplay and share it around, you know, different content sites or within your teams. That's, you know, it went from like, oh, GIFs are kind of superficial to actually being really productive. So to do that, we're going to open Photoshop. Cursed Adobe has not allowed us to export GIFs from After Effects, even though that is a large contingency of their users. Actually, that's not really true. After Effects is used in like movie studios, and they like totally outpower us designers, but that's okay. So everyone open Photoshop. I'll give you a moment to do that. If you don't have Photoshop installed, you can download a trial online or go to Terpware or something. But we're going to use Photoshop to actually export this to a GIF. So it's converting it from a movie to a GIF. And the way this is going to work is, if you remember those frames we talked about, those are the sub, you know, the intervals of time within your movie. We've actually made it 24 frames per second. So if our entire movie is 2 seconds long, how many frames do we have? 48. Good work, comp sci students. Math. No, but the reason I say that is because each of these single frames is actually a full image. And you'll see that in Photoshop. So what we're going to do is click File, Import, and then Video Frames to Layers. So again, this is taking the frames from our video and making each of them an individual image within Photoshop on a separate layer. So again, that was File, Import, Video Frames to Layers. We're going to navigate to wherever we've stored this and just stick with the defaults. Cool. Now your window is probably going to look a little different from mine. The only thing I use Photoshop anymore is converting movies to GIFs. So this is my default. But to get yours to look like mine, you can click Window, Workspace, Motion. And that'll put you in the, it'll open up the correct panels to allow you to do what we're about to do. So we've done two things. We've done File, Import, Video Frames to Layers, and then we've gone over to Window, Workspace, Motion. Is everyone at this stage? Does your screen look sort of like this? Cool. So at this stage, we're going to do just a couple different things. For starters, you're going to go down to the bottom left and make sure that Forever is checked. It might say something like Once. And since we're exporting this to a GIF, we want to make sure that GIF autoplays and loops. So that's, you know, what GIFs are basically for these days on the internet. Alternatively, you can have like an intro animation that only goes once and stays. That's what Once would be used for. But we're going to make sure Forever is checked so that this GIF loops over and over and over and over again until you change screens. Awesome. We don't need to change anything. If you were doing something maybe a little more advanced, you might want to play with the frames a little bit. But we can see here that these are actually frame by frame what we've created in After Effects. See that? Whoa. Very cool. And from here, we're going to do an export one more time. This is the final step. So click File, Export, and actually we're going to use Save for Web Legacy. If you're on CC, just use the legacy. Just do it. And within here, we have a few presets. For simplicity's sake, we're going to just select, say, GIF 64 dithered. Now these are a number of parameters that will affect the output or the output quality or file type, things like that. The main things to know are that you want a GIF selected, you want dithering on, which is kind of like the way, it's similar to like aliasing. It makes your image colors work differently. And the number of colors we're going to set to 64. We could set this down to like 8 if we wanted to, but it would look bad. So we're going to use 64. Everything you do to increase the quality of this image is going to also increase the file size. So if you're looking to distribute this on the internet, GIFs are super heavy. Remember, this is like, if this animation is 2 seconds, that's 48 separate pictures at that full resolution. So GIFs are really heavy. Sometimes you'll need to adjust these down to just make it, you know, able to export it all. But we have no problem here. We're at like 500 kilobytes, and we'll be fine. So From there, we can click save. Save it wherever you want it. Hacktorialfun.gif. And at this point, we should be able to go over to your browser or to anywhere else you consume GIFs and open up and have a looping animated GIF. Did it! Good job, everybody! Woohoo! All right. So at this point, you've done the full life cycle of motion design and animation. If anyone is interested to go deeper, we can. There are a lot of features that might make this like fully seamless or add more of that interactivity from the original image that we want, but I think this is a really good start. And if you guys are going to do future motion projects, just remember that every animation or every interaction that you're prototyping is really just a combination of those parameters over different keyframes. So you really do have all the skills you need to make any of these sorts of crazy, wacky animations and fun things just using After Effects. Granted, you do need to create those source files, so that'll be fun, but that's a hacktorial for another time. Cool. Shall we open to questions? Yeah. The keyframes? Cool. We'll go over that again. That's a pretty tricky step. So first we're going to open up whatever layer we're working on, whatever the source is that we're going to copy from. So I think in this case we were using one of the opacities, maybe on like the title. So I'm just going to set myself back a little bit by deleting those. You guys don't have to follow along if you already picked this up. You can play around in After Effects or something. So all we're going to do is drag over the actual dots that we're going to copy. So in this case, we want to copy the opacity going from 0 to 100 at 1 second to 112. Cool? So we're going to navigate into shirt title, go down to the parameters, and drag over it like I am here. Okay? And then we'll press Command C for copy. And then I'm going to select all of the places I want to paste it. So in this case, the whole point of doing this is to increase our efficiency and duplicate that keyframe. The keyframing over different layers. So we're going to select all four of those layers. And then the last step is to put the timeline cursor at the very start of that animation, because wherever you paste it, it's going to go to where that timeline cursor is. And then finally, we'll press Command V to paste those in. And now what we've done is we've duplicated that fade in over four different objects at once. Cool? Sick. Great. Other questions, guys? Maybe a question like, how would I approach this if I wanted to do this? Yeah.
Imagine that studios use this to animate movies.
I mean, did you see the masterpiece that was presented before of the dancers spinning around? It was awesome. No, I'm just kidding. So After Effects is used a ton. If you think of if a movie studio is using the Adobe Suite, they're likely using like Premiere, which is like, imagine the sequencing, but just sequencing, and that done really well. And then After Effects is used often for like editing or motion graphics. So anytime you're in like a silly action movie and it like, you know, has a aerial view of the White House and like these numbers fade into like 0100, like Washington DC. Like that's probably After Effects. It's also used for things like editing the, it's used for like color grading a lot and just like more like editing the source footage. None of the stuff we did was like live footage, but if you're dealing with that, After Effects has a wide range of things that allow you to edit that. But yeah, I mean, that's basically it. Cool. Other questions, guys? All right. Well, oh, yeah, Travis.
How do you, like, hide and reveal certain parts of your movie?
Cool. So at this point, Travis asked, how do we hide and reveal certain parts of an image? We'll go over masking real quick. But it is a little more advanced. If you want to just like play around with what you have, or you want to roll out, that's totally cool. We've completed like the full cycle of After Effects, and these are going to be a little bit more of the advanced techniques. So you've been warned. Cool. So this is actually done with a technique called masking. So I'm just going to open up a time that I've done it. Cool. So this project has some masking in it. What's happening here? You see how this image the source is not included. But do you see how if that were an image, it's revealing a certain bit at a time? Right? So the way this works is you basically are maintaining a background image and then using what's called a mask to show different parts of it at different times. And so with a mask, you can treat it like any other keyframeable object and animate that over time. So you start with like, the mask over here off screen and then translate it in to reveal different parts of the image. That's actually like a little more advanced, so I'm not going to go over it, but you can just look up After Effects masking tutorial and it should be pretty straightforward. Cool. Other questions? Do we want to go deeper into the pants changer animation? Talk to me, guys.
Yes.
There we go. One voice for the masses. Great. So I'm going to open After Effects again. In this case, let's actually just open, if you remember, there are different source files that I provided. So why don't we go to the one that's actually labeled completed, and I'll just walk through like how each of those are set up. Because we won't have time to do it all, so I might as well show you it all and then tell you how it works. So go to wherever you downloaded that. We're going to open up the one that's labeled for completed. So it should be Hectorial Pants Changer for completed. I need to find it myself. OK. Does everyone have that open? I don't myself. I guess I should do it on that. Okay, so you'll see just by opening this, there's a mass amount of keyframes in there, right? So we added like no more than two different parameters to each object, but sometimes you'll add even more. Sometimes, you're using the same parameters to change this over different interactions. So in this case, we have different stages of this animation. We have a cursor moving over to represent how a human is using this interface. And then we have the on-click animation. So that's actually what we just went over. So that's scaling the image up, changing the background, and animating in the metadata. And then for sake of making it seamless, I have it go all the way back by clicking the back button and then fading back out. So that's like four, maybe five different stages. And you can see those represented with all the different keyframes. So each of those represents a change in the parameters of that object. And again, I don't want to necessarily go through all of this, but you can try to maybe like, when you're home tonight, like recreate the final form of it and like see what it takes to get there. But I'll just make some like notes of how it all goes together. So we have a cursor and a cursor glow. So the way I represent the click is actually by moving a circle on top of this and then animating a different circle outwards. You see that right there? So that's actually a circle that's just scaling and being more opaque, or more transparent, right? To represent that burst, which represents clicking. So once we have the burst, this part you did, this is exactly as I did it myself. And the fade-in is right there. A few more details on the fade-in. We actually, if you pay attention to the numbers, they count up. Do you see that? And that's actually done with a slightly more advanced technique. As opposed to putting in text from Illustrator, this is another case where you would need to generate it inside of After Effects. So each of these numbers are generated differently with a text layer. And then you actually have a keyframe that allows you to animate the number the same way you would any other parameter. So we set that number value at 0 at one keyframe and like 4 at a different one. And over that time, the number will increase from 0 to 1 to 3, or 0 to 1 to 2 to 3 to 4. So that's how that little count up is done. And you'll see all of that happen down here. It says like 3, 8, 4, and then the sizes. So these are all the keyframes that are animating them in and then changing their values. Okay? So from there, other things we're doing, we have the cursor move back over to the back button. The back button animates out a little bit. That's just a translation, both of them. It's just moving over keyframes. And then from there, we have the green background go from 100% opacity to 0% opacity to become fully transparent again and reveal that original background. Sound good? Cool. You'll notice in like the final form product, some of the keyframes aren't lined up exactly. So my suggestion for you is to begin with that technical approach, like really thinking about what numbers you're using and trying to line everything up. And then at the very end, thinking optically, so like how it looks and how it lines up exactly, you might find that due to an easing curve, something doesn't appear until halfway through the animation. And so you want to think about that in your final keyframes and just kind of move things around and shift them until it looks optically correct to you. Because that's what matters at the end of the day. No one sees this unless you give a hectorial on it later. Cool. Other things we want to go over? Philosophical questions? Motion things? All right. Well, cool. Thanks, everybody. Enjoy your newfound skills in motion design. I hope to see what you create. Definitely send me anything you do create with this stuff. I'm very curious to see it. And yeah, I'll wrap up. Thanks, folks. Goodbye, internet people.